This man is worth $500. And this man's going to collect. He's Jake Cahill, and he lives by bounty law.
The film that I have watched the most this year has been Quentin Tarantino's Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. It's kind of been my 2021 comfort movie. I have watched it a ton, too much probably, sometimes all the way through. Sometimes, you know, just having it on in the background or rewatching specific scenes. But it has been the film that I have watched the most this year. I have loved this film ever since I first saw it back in theaters in 2019. It was my favorite movie of that year, either that or Martin Scorsese's The Irishman. It was one of my most anticipated of that year, and watching it for the first time in the theaters was one of the best experiences I had had all year. Quentin Tarantino is one of my favorite filmmakers of all time. Ever since I first saw Pulp Fiction and Reservoir Dogs when I was like 13, he's been one of my favorite directors. I love all of his films, and since I saw Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, I've only grown to love it more and more, and it has quickly become one of my favorites from him, which is a lot considering how much I enjoy all of his films. Once Upon a Time in Hollywood is very Quentin Tarantino, but it's also something very different from him. It's not a crime film, it's not a story of revenge or redemption. Once Upon a Time in Hollywood is a love letter. A love letter to an era, to the music, the movies, the TV, the actors and filmmakers. A love letter to the first era of Hollywood that Tarantino grew up loving. Of course, it has its amazing soundtrack, its bursts of Tarantino violence, crazy characters with witty dialogue, and all the other things that you want and expect from a Quentin Tarantino picture. But it's also warm and sentimental in a way that no other Tarantino film is. Most of the film is just a day in these people's lives. It's 2.5 hours of spending the day with Rick Dalton, Cliff Booth, and Sharon Tate.
It's official, old buddy. Well, has been.
What are you talking about? What did that guy tell you?
Told me the goddamn truth is what he told me.
Whoa, whoa. Hey.
I'm sorry about that. I'm sorry about that.
Here, put these on. Don't cry in front of the Mexicans.
The relationship between Rick Dalton and Cliff Booth is the core of the movie. The bounty law star and his stunt double are the driving force of the film.
Is that how you describe your job, Cliff?
What, carrying his load? Yeah, it's about right.
It's a buddy hangout movie with these two who are more than brothers but less than a wife. It's clear that they care for each other, that they're good friends to each other. Cliff works for Rick, he drives him around and he fixes his TV. But when Rick's episode of FBI airs, Cliff has a six-pack in the back and orders some pizza. The friendship is my favorite part of the film, and I don't think that I've liked a duo in movies this much since Ryan Gosling and Russell Crowe in Shane Black's The Nice Guys. I could watch a series of movies on the adventures of Rick Dalton and Cliff Booth.
Hey!
You're Rick fucking Dalton. Don't you forget it.
And a huge reason why I love those characters are because of the incredible performances from the actors portraying them. I love Leonardo DiCaprio as Rick Dalton.
Bunch of goddamn fucking hippies.
An Eisenhower actor in a Dennis Hopper Hollywood who's being left behind and won't change with the times, who's self-destructive, who won't go to Italy and star in Italian westerns because he thinks that they're terrible, even though he's never seen one.
Wants to help me get into Italian movies.
Well, then what's the problem?
I gotta do fucking Italian goddamn movies, that's a fucking problem.
Come on.
Fucking bullshit.
Leo is obviously one of the best actors alive, and he has a filmography filled with all-time performances. He's amazing in his other film with Tarantino, Django Unchained, and two of my favorites from him are his performances in Martin Scorsese's The Wolf of Wall Street and The Aviator, but, I mean, this guy's filmography. The Departed, Shutter Island, Titanic, The Revenant, Catch Me If You Can, Critters 3, Gangs of New York, and I could go on and on. My favorite Leo performances tend to be the ones where he gets to be a bit silly and crazy, like in The Wolf of Wall Street or in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
Line.
Maybe he already has.
maybe... God damn it, I fucked this whole thing.
He's very underrated as a comedic actor, and his performance in this film is one of his best. And it's a character that becomes more and more interesting and layered every time I watch it. Some of my favorite stuff in the movie is him beating himself up in the trailer, which is an all too real and relatable scene, or him at lunch talking with the young actress, who's incredible, crying about how he relates to the book that he's reading, or him on the set of Lancer, seeing Leo as Rick in his full acting glory, or just his back and forth in friendship with Cliff Booth. I absolutely love him.
Murdoch Lancer puts $50,000 in my lap, or I'll eat this little pitcher down a well. You got that, Boston? Huh?
Yeah.
All right, messenger boy. Deliver my message.
Brad Pitt is another one of my favorite actors, and his performance as Cliff Booth is one of my favorites from him ever.
We love pussy.
Yes, we do.
Brad Pitt is arguably the coolest and most handsome man in Hollywood. Very few people can be as cool on screen as Brad Pitt can. I mean, look at him. He's so cool. He's the coolest. Look how cool he is. Not only is he very cool, he's also a fantastic actor with a filmography as good as anyone's. Seven, Fight Club, Moneyball, The Assassination of Jesse James by the Coward Robert Ford, Killing Them Softly, Sinbad, Legend of the Seven Seas, The Ocean's Films, and I could go on and on and on. He's one of the best, he's one of the coolest, and he is absolutely perfect as Cliff Booth, the cool stuntman, Rick's gopher. He's a war hero, and he might have killed his wife, but what's great about Cliff Booth, other than how truly cool and go with the flow he is how good of a friend he is to Rick.
You're a good friend, Cliff.
I tried.
And I love the scenes of him just driving down LA while a classic song from the 60s plays. I love the scene on Spahn Ranch, which might be the most tense scene in Tarantino history. The fear of what he's going to find, but the coolness as he walks back to Rick's car with the Manson people screaming at him. I love it. I love it so much. He's one of my favorite Tarantino characters ever, and I am so glad that Brad Pitt won the Oscar for it. As fun as Rick and Cliff are together, the heart of Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, the bright light that brings a smile to your face, is Margot Robbie as Sharon Tate. Margot Robbie is one of my favorite actors working. She might be my favorite actress right now. I've been a fan since Pan Am. Remember Pan Am? What a show. But when The Wolf of Wall Street came out and was like my favorite movie from 2013, along with About Time, which she's also in, I was like, who is that? And have pretty much watched everything she's been in since. She's amazing, and she's really great as Sharon Tate.
I mean, I'm in the movie. I'm Sharon Tate.
You're in this?
Mm-hmm. I play Miss Carlson, the Klutz. That's me.
I didn't know Sharon Tate personally. I don't know what she was like, but I find all of the scenes of Margot as Tate driving around LA, picking up books, watching her own movie, just a day in her life, to be really sweet, charming, and kind of beautiful. Some people had issue with the amount of dialogue that she had and how most of our time with her is just spent watching her sort of regular day, which maybe some people found mundane, but I was glad that Sharon Tate wasn't turned into a Tarantino character with his voice and dialogue. I liked the distance kept. It felt respectful, like we were really watching Sharon Tate and not just Tarantino's Sharon Tate. She's a shining light in the film, the embodiment of a smile, and the movie is filled with a lot of gray characters, egotistical actors, stuntmen who might have murdered a few people, Roman Polanski, and then there's the truly evil characters lurking in the background. But with Sharon Tate, you're just smiling. It portrays her as a kind and beautiful person. It invites us in on this sweet day in her life, and it gives her an ending that she deserved. When the film was coming out, it was always referred to as Quentin Tarantino's Manson Murders movie, and I thought that was interesting, Tarantino dealing with the Manson murders, but the movie that we got, Manson is almost an afterthought. He's there, and we see him, and the hippies at Spawn Ranch, and there is this haunting feeling around them, but for the most part, you're caught up in having fun with Rick and Cliff, or spending the day with Sharon. In the end, I almost forgot about them, and then they show back up, and Quentin flips it on us once again. And the ending to Once Upon a Time in Hollywood is crazy and violent and hilarious and amazing. Brad Pitt as High Cliff Booth is just so much fun.
And you were on a horsey. Yeah. You are...
I'm the devil. And I'm here to do the devil's business.
No, I was dumber than that.
And I loved the Inglourious Bastards, like, history-changing ending. It's a lot of fun. And the flamethrower bit with Rick and the pool was just incredible. And it's just one of the most entertaining endings to a Quentin Tarantino movie.
Is everybody okay?
Well, the fucking hippies aren't. That's for goddamn sure.
But I do know that some people had problems with it. Some people felt that it was disrespectful to people like Sharon Tate and Jay Sebring and all the people who were murdered that night, and I get that, absolutely. It was a horrible event, and it's tricky when you're dealing with real-life people and real-life tragic events in movies, so I would never tell people how they should feel about something like that, but for me, personally, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, like the title suggests, is a bit of a fairy tale, and it's nice to live in this world where for a few hours the real life horrors don't happen. The evil murderers get torched, and Sharon Tate in a Don Meredith Dallas Cowboys jersey gets to invite Rick Dalton over and get a happy ending. And I know it's not everyone's favorite Tarantino movie. I know some people who didn't like it at all, and that there's too much driving around LA while a classic song from the 60s plays, or that it's self-indulgent, that it's another one of those movies set in Los Angeles that's in love with Los Angeles, that it's another movie made by Hollywood that's romanticizing Hollywood. And I get it. I really do. I even get being over Quentin Tarantino and people's problems with how the film portrays its real-life people, which I am not here to defend because I totally understand why people would be upset by that, but Once Upon a Time in Hollywood hit me perfectly and I loved it. Maybe I was always going to love it. I love Tarantino, I love Leo, I love Brad Pitt, I love Margot Robbie, I love movies about old Hollywood, I love movies about people making movies, I love movies about movies. I really loved this movie. Once Upon a Time in Hollywood is a fairy tale, a love letter to a bygone era of Hollywood and filmmaking, a reflection of that time, an era that ended with the real-life events of 1969, and the film is almost mournful of it, and then gives it its fairy tale ending. Once Upon a Time in Hollywood is a day in the life story. It's a hangout movie. It's Tarantino's warmest, it might be his funniest. And Quentin has mentioned time and time again that he only plans on making 10 films, which means, as of right now, there's only one more left. And while it sucks to imagine a world with no more Quentin Tarantino movies to look forward to, I'm excited for that final film, and I'm sure it's going to be great. But there is something about Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, this sentimental love letter to the Hollywood of Tarantino's childhood that would have been the perfect film for him to go out on. It almost feels like a goodbye. And I love it. I really, really do. It's become my comfort movie of the year. The movie that I've rewatched the most. I've watched it so many times. It just is a movie that makes me happy. And it takes me back to those pre-pandemic times. 2019, which was an incredible year for films. And I've also recently read the book, the Once Upon a Time in Hollywood novelization that Tarantino wrote. And I loved that. It adds a lot more backstory and recontextualizes some stuff. If you haven't read it and you love the movie, I'd recommend checking that out. And also, from watching some of the interviews that Quentin did while the book was coming out, he had said that he had a lot of scenes that he cut out of the film and that there could be like a extra long, like, I don't know, maybe 4-hour long cut that he has. I would love to see that, even if it's too long and not as good. I just want to see those extra scenes. I just want to see that extra long 4-hour cut. I hope he releases it one day. I think that could be really cool, because I love this movie. It's become one of my favorite movies. One of my favorite movies from him too, which is saying a lot, because like I said, I love all of his films. But this movie has become one of my favorites. I absolutely love Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.